In this endeavor, where we are beginning with three courses which have been tested by IIT Bombay in global offering on MOOCs as well as offering for the Indian students on IIT Bombay X. So, before introducing the faculty colleagues who are behind this, I thought I will very quickly give you a glimpse of IIT Bombay X platform. Like any MOOCs platform, you would see a front screen. So, if you go to Coursera or edX, you will find similar screens there which list the number of courses which are available on that platform. The standard procedure is that anybody who wishes to do a MOOC will first register on that site once, giving the email ID and giving a publicly visible name as a single string. In fact, MOOCs do not wish to know what your background is, where you are from. That is the nature of openness. Your privacy is guaranteed because you, although you give your full name for the purpose of certification, etcetera, etcetera, that is never revealed. In India, unfortunately, we do not have privacy laws. And in fact, we specialize in our colleges to collect all private information about every student and every staff member, although it is irrelevant many times. But we maintain it, and we don't guarantee that we don't reveal that information. That is the status. It will change after some time anyway. Why I am telling you this is that when we collect information about learners on the MOOCs platform, it is an extremely limited information. The MOOCs as such does not need any other information because they are open courses. When we ran our courses, for example, in my computer programming course, we had 60,000 enrollments, and there were several kids of 12 and 13 years old, and there were stalwarts of 65 and 75 years old also were learning. We never knew what they were doing, whether they were teachers, students, lawyers, whatever, whatever. It doesn't matter. And that is, in fact, the main power of MOOCs, that anybody can learn any subject from whomsoever one chooses. Once you log in into this, you have two roles. One is you are a learner. That is what most of your students would be, that they will register on IIT Bombay X and then enroll for either of the courses that are offered under blended. If you see the dashboard, where once I log in, I will see these things. If I choose a particular course, I will be able to see these things. So, for example, if I go to courseware, this is what the students will say. This is a demo course.
Hi again. Oops. I am Gayatri and I am here to help you put together your courses. As you know, online.
The point of this is that these videos are played here, and if there is a transcript given, so if I go somewhere else here, the video automatically advances. Now, this is a facility for the learners to view those samples of the video again and again which where they have a problem. Unfortunately, what has been observed is most people use this facility to literally sample the video. They don't watch the complete lecture. And one of the important hallmarks of a MOOC is MOOCs never ever have a 1 hour recorded lecture, which is our standard way of interacting. They always have 8 to 10 minute snippets. Many of my own colleagues find it very difficult because we have never learned to compress the explanation of a concept in 8 to 10 minutes. We are used to teaching in a different style. Now, this is what the MOOCs do. Here, on in any course of a particular lesson one, for example, you will have multiple things here. For example, here is an assignment that people will do. Okay, there could be some material. There is another video lecture here. There are videos and problems. There are some take note questions. Things are assembled on the top for every week or every topic, and people could go through that. There would be a graded quiz which is automatically graded, and students will get to know their score the moment they appear for that quiz. Generally, when we run a course, the course has a sequence and that sequence has to be followed, but that sequence has to be kept as open as possible. For example, if there is a 6 week course, it is not uncommon to have a weekly schedule. The material for the entire week is exposed to the learners immediately on the beginning of the week. there are sample problems which they can attempt and they will get answers whether they are correct or not, etc. The quiz is typically released on the last day of the week and is kept open for 48 hours. This is so much different from our insistence that the quiz will be for 20 minutes, it will be supervised and so on. And this is because we never know which person has which convenient time to sit and answer the quiz. Now, whenever a student or a learner attempts a quiz, all events, by the way, are logged at the back end. So, we would know at what time which question was attempted by a student, how long the student remained on the quiz. All of these things are captured through what we call event logs. Unfortunately, these event logs result in a very, very large unstructured document. I mean, gigabytes of data can be created through the student interaction, and its analysis requires what we call big data analytics. Now, work is going on everywhere. We have managed, OpenEDX has managed to analyze some of the events. We are continuing to handle more events. Currently, what we are able to capture is which quizzes were attempted by the student at what point. Overall, how much time the student spent on various activities. This is an ongoing work. The point is, at the end of a week, the student either completes that quiz or does not complete that quiz. If the designated day is over, the student may attempt that quiz, but those marks are not counted towards the evaluation. At the end of these 5 weeks or 6 weeks of course, a final exam is typically held. Almost all exams on MOOCs are multiple choice questions, as Professor Sudarshan was saying, that is not necessarily the only way of doing things. However, for some specialized courses such as computer programming course, we have introduced an autograder where people can submit their programs and those programs are automatically graded. And unlike what he said, giving 0 or 1 mark, we actually spend a lot of time in designing the problem or assignment for that programming project. We give actually a structure consisting of several divisions. Just like in a handwritten paper, if a student makes a mistake somewhere in a program, we reduce 1 mark. But if something else is correct, we give partial marks for that. In exactly the same fashion, our autograder is capable of evaluating each segment independently and find out whether it is correct or not, and partial grading is possible. Now, this kind of thing is not always possible in all other subjects. Particularly, automatically evaluating long answers is still a matter of research. However, what this platform provides, again based on OpenEDX backend, it provides what we call an assessment of text answers through two mechanisms, either through machine learning algorithms, if you have one available, but mostly through peer grading. Now, peer grading is another mechanism that we are evaluating. Obviously, it is impossible at this juncture to consider marks obtained through peer grading in any formal evaluation. But such are the possibilities, and going forward, all these possibilities will be actually incorporated in these things. The eventual aim, as Professor Sudarshan mentioned, I do not know whether you are aware or not, but advancing personalized instruction is actually regarded as one of the grand challenges for this century. Some of you may be aware that National Academy of Engineers in the United States, which published 20 great achievements of the previous century, has actually put together 14 grand challenges of engineering for this century. One of the 14 grand challenges is advancing personalized instruction. Now, personalized tutoring is nothing new. 20, 30 years people have been writing intelligent tutoring systems, but most of them provide additional material for me to study based on my performance in some courses. So, basically my performance in the previous quizzes is taken as the only major parameter on which it is decided what more things I should study. If there are 100 students with the same performance, the fact is that these 100 students have different learning styles. Some look at the complete material very critically before attempting exams. Some will directly jump to exam. Some will look at some solved problems first. Now, if this is my learning habit, then targeting the extra material to me should be in sync with these learning habits of mine. So far, these learning habits could never be captured. Even in a classroom, when we engage with students, we have no clue on how much time the student spends on what activity back at home. But on MOOCs, you can capture the learning habit. And the research area that is now thronging is how to translate the knowledge of these learning habits into some kind of measurable parameter and use them for advancing personalized learning. All that is future research work. So let me come back to this IIT Bombay X thing. So far, IIT Bombay has offered courses. First, as partners of EDX in a global consortium, we have offered courses in the global learning community. Then, when we built IIT Bombay X, we offered the same courses to Indian students, where we collect some more information about the student, which is what is your location and what is your PIN code. PIN code is unique to India, and therefore, we are able to say whether the student is from India or from Moscow or from someplace else. We have no problem other people learning those courses, but we are primarily targeting to Indian students. As I said, there are Hindi translations available for lectures and so on. So, why three courses? Because these three courses were offered first to the global community. These three courses were then translated or dubbed into Hindi, and we have some more about it. We have interacted with some of the remote centers in an experiment on mentoring online students, etc., last semester. And therefore, we said we could start this experiment of mainstreaming MOOCs using these three courses. So, I would like to introduce my colleagues here, Professor Uday Gaitonde, who led the initial efforts on the thermodynamics course. He is unfortunately in Pune. In any case, he has passed over the leadership mantle of that team to Professor Upendra Bhandarkar. I thought, Upendra is there. And Professor Milind Atre. Milind is there, yes. Professor Milind Atre, by the way, wears multiple hats. He is also professor in charge of SAI in our incubator. I understand somebody handles the entrepreneurship thing. So, he is the head of our entrepreneurship activities here as well. And of course, for the limited purpose of our interaction, he is the team member of ME209. We also have a course in signals and systems. Originally, the signals and system course was taught as a T10KT workshop by late Professor Somnath Sengupta of IIT Kharagpur and Professor Vikram Gadre of IIT Bombay. Vikram has created this course jointly with some of his other research scholars and colleagues. Vikram is not here, unfortunately, but we have his teammates. Can you just introduce yourself? I have forgotten your names already. Ashwet, yeah, and Abhinav. Right. The third course is computer programming course, which is taught by Professor Supratik Chakravarti, my colleague. I did not see Supratik is not here, but I am here. I am the other member of the team, and we also have Nagesh Karmari and Firuza. Firuza is not here; her parents are unwell, but Nagesh is here. Now, having done these three courses, when we thought about blending it, we tried to see whether these courses will make sense or not. Let me tell you, eventually the idea is that such courses should be not just the basic core courses, should also be electives, and such courses need not be created and offered by IIT Bombay alone. They can be created and offered by very good accomplished teachers from any institution. So, the effort is to bring all of these together and merge it with our conventional education system. Now, most of you would have seen the paper and the documentation that I had circulated to you. It is my own opinion, endorsed by many others, that bringing the two together will not work unless there is a formal recognition of the assessment done in online courses and the assessment done in our conventional thing together. Because with all said and done, while we may tell our students, "Arey, this is a great knowledge there, learn it on your own," the attention will be paid to such material maybe by 3%, 5% of the students. Majority of our students will work, will learn something, but will work only if there are marks associated with some assessment involved in that program. If there are no marks, I have no particular desire to spend time on. This is one of the reasons why MOOCs have seen very large enrollments but very poor finishing rates, because those certificates, what value those certificates have, we do not. That value, however, is increasing. In the United States, it has started happening that if you have done certain MOOCs courses from certain professors and obtained a pass grade, that is now being factored into job interviews and job allotment. It has started happening in India also, although most of the employers currently use additional online testing, but some recognition has started. What it means is that increasingly the employers are finding that degrees and marks in the degrees cannot be the only criteria for shortlisting people for jobs. In fact, you will notice that in our own conventional education stream, we notice that many public sector units are actually asking for your GATE score. Now, why GATE score? I mean, I have a degree from this college, but somehow public sector units believe that GATE score is an independent evaluation, so they will factor that. And it is not uncommon to find that interview committees for people with similar good marks will prefer a person with a higher GATE score. Now, that has started happening. What it means is that society at large and the employers at large eventually will start factoring such independent assessment and evaluation on their own. Another reason why I thought our university system should bring the MOOCs into mainstream is such that their degrees are not left alone and hanging, but their degrees get weightage of the additional inputs that the students are given through these MOOCs courses. Now, all this is well known to you. The idea here is very simple. We are not trying to transform the complete education system in one semester. That is impossible, not even attempting. But what we are trying to say is that all of us who teach a course here, if I can say that while my assessment will evaluate to these 100 marks today, instead of giving my grade based only on these 100 marks, if I agree that I will factor some portion from the MOOC's assessment into my final grade, that will immediately bring a sanctity of the MOOC's activity and students will pay attention to that MOOC's activity. Now, what percentage should I decide to allocate to that MOOC score? Which part of the MOOC score I should consider? This is a matter which theoretically every individual teacher teaching a course should decide, because that is what autonomy of a teacher is. Unfortunately, the autonomy of a teacher in many institutions is restricted to the autonomy of the institution, which is further restricted to the autonomy of the university, which is further restricted by what UGC and AICTE announces. So, I first tried to generalize from our own experience. Let me tell you what our experience is. Last year, we conducted the same experiment in IIT Bombay, when Professor Supratik and I taught CS101 course to some 550 students of IIT Bombay. And we said, we would like to assess students through online exams and we would like to run flipped classroom. We will not conduct lectures at all. We will just conduct discussion sessions. And all evaluation of that online exam will be considered as part of our course grade. Only the final exam will be conducted as it. Final exam has 30% weightage in our case, 70% weightage to me. Both of us went to the Dean Academic Programs to tell him that, look, we will be writing a letter to you seeking your permission, but we have come for initial discussion. You know what our dean said? He said, but this is your course. Why do you require anybody's permission? So, maybe you send a letter to me informing me that this is how you will conduct the course. Now, that is the autonomy we are privileged to enjoy. I doubt very much whether such autonomy exists even in other IITs, forget other institutes, where a teacher who decides how the teacher will evaluate the students has to be endorsed at least by the local academic standing committee. Like in our case, SINET is the supreme academic authority. But SINET does not go into these nitty-gritties, it leaves it to individual teachers. Eventually, I would expect at least the enlightened institutions which are represented here to have that kind of autonomy given to the teacher, and ultimately that should translate into autonomy of a learner. But these are all long-term things. We know for sure, for example, that all of your institutions, why we have chosen you, let me also tell you that. First of all, university system will take a long time to take such decisions. The only institutions which can take such decisions which are either autonomous institutions are deemed to be universities. Even there, they will have a due process. They will have academic bodies which will have to consider this and then take a decision. For example, Director NIT Bhopal wrote to me saying that since I do not have my Senate's permission, I will not be able to join this endeavor. Now, it's a chicken and egg. I do not even know what permission I am seeking from Senate. So, this conclave is actually to discuss what is it that we ought to do, both in terms of formal mechanisms of endorsing our decisions and in terms of practical implement. Now, one suggestion that I have for this blended MOOCs offering is, these are the three courses. You should identify the teachers in your institutions who teach the corresponding courses. They should actually evaluate in detail what are the syllabus that is covered here, what is the syllabus that is covered there, etc. They should be free to decide what portion of the MOOCs course will be considered as useful for their students. And they may decide that this portion of evaluation they will consider towards their component of evaluation, this portion they will not. We do not want a decision to be taken that all participating institutions must do this. That is nonsense, because that makes a mockery of the autonomy of individual teachers and institutions. What we propose to do is, so we will discuss this blended mode, and when I will describe later the blended mode dashboard that we have made for the participating teachers, I will just mention two things. In terms of formal interaction that is required, there will be two stages of interaction. One is, we would expect a in charge teacher teaching any one of these courses in your place to submit to IIT Bombay the email IDs of all students enrolled for that course under that teacher there. There are 100 students doing thermodynamics. The teacher should submit a list of 100 students saying, these are my former students. And IIT Bombay will ensure that the performance of these 100 students on the online quizzes of that particular course are routinely communicated to that teacher. Similarly, the teacher will be able to download all the evaluations for the entire semester, and it is up to that teacher and that institute to decide what part of this assessment, what part of this evaluation should be considered as a component for the final grade. What is required, however, is that there should be a non-trivial component of the online assessment that should be considered by the institute participating in. Then and only then this will happen. Now, in this endeavor, since we are attempting it for the first time, there will be a large number of questions, and I am sure many of those questions are already there in your mind. Just to request those of you who have some very pertinent points to raise them. We will note them. We will not necessarily be able to answer all of those questions, but anybody who has thought of any issue, let it be articulated so that all of us are aware of various problems that we face, and we would like to resolve these problems eventually before the end of the day, so that we can take this forward. But one thing I will tell you, this kind of effort of recognizing the MOOCs marks into regular university credits by a large number of institutions has not happened anywhere in the world. So, we have no precedents to go by. Traditionally, our reaction is, has it been tried in MIT or Harvard or Oxford or something? Okay, if not, has it been handled in IIT Delhi or something? Means, has it been done by somebody else? Then I will try to venture. It has not been done by anybody else. We have now an opportunity to create history, because I am convinced that today these 50 institutions are starting. Next year there will be 500 institutions, and year after that there could be all 5000 engineering colleges. That is the scale at which we need to quickly, rapidly move up. And that is why it is more important for us to somehow make this experiment succeed and become meaningful. So, we would like to derive learnings from this experiment. Towards the end, you would notice in the write up that I have given for the schedule, you will notice a funny name called Formation of Advisory Board for the Consortium. So, what consortium, what advisory board? So, let me tell you that before I throw open the discussion. This group of 53 institutions which is participating in this endeavor, in my humble suggestion, forms a consortium. This is the first consortium of independent institutions which are autonomous, which are coming together to do this task. IIT Bombay is one member of the consortium. It may be first amongst equal because we have taken the lead, but we are all together and equal in this experiment. Today, IIT Bombay is offering MOOCs. As I said, tomorrow great quality MOOCs can be offered by teachers of any institution. There are certain thumb rules which all of us are aware of. For example, the choice of people who will offer a MOOC is not done through a tender process or some such thing, or just saying please come in. It's done very, very, we go to the teachers who have participated in our T10KT projects earlier, who have an idea of how to interact with 10,000 people. We go to teachers who have won best teacher awards in IIT. So we know that they have a passion for teaching which is recognized by the student. We also know that they are experts not only in the subject, but experts in explaining, which is what teaching is all about. I am sure all of you know from your own place who are the best teachers. In future, I would expect the members of this consortium to contribute to creation of MOOCs and contribute to offering of MOOCs, which could be taken by not only these consortium students, but anybody. And we will make all endeavors to make, first of all, this software itself as open source. If you want, you can run it. Eventually, if the funding is released by MHRD, we will be glad to host your such courses on IIT Bombay X on your behalf as part of the consortium. All these are possible. The advisory council, which I have indicated in the consortium, which will form at the end, but I would like to mention it now so that you can start thinking about whether you would like to offer your services to be the member of that advisory council. First and foremost, this consortium will be a short-lived consortium in the present sense, because there is no definition. The advisory council has to define what the consortium constitution is. My own suggestion is to form a simple multilateral MOU between all 53 institutions, saying together for 1 year we want to do this experiment. Such a multilateral MOU signed formally by all 53 institutions including IIT Bombay will also provide some sanctity for each of us to go back to our own academic body and say that we are in this formally together. It will be a non-binding MOU. I would like advisory council to spend some time in the evening to decide on the broad structure. It should not be a 20-page MOU. It could be a just 2-page or 3-page MOU, but a formal document. Second and more important, I would like this advisory council to constantly monitor over the next 1 year the progress and the execution of this experiment, and should advise all constituent institutions, including IIT Bombay, if there is something that is not working properly or any additional suggestion that would be given. This would be the main job of this advisory council at the end. Do you agree that such a structure would be meaningful? Because then it will mean that we have an independent thing, not what I say, not he, what he says, not what he says, but a composite voice of all of us. So this is our general formulation of the organization. Now I would like to open up the debate, and I would be very keen to listen to individual observations on the proposed model. I would particularly like you to say what problems do you envisage, if any, and if there is any additional operational mechanism that you have thought of which could be useful for all of us. Yeah, Dr. Mugera.
Professor, let me compliment on behalf of the participants on the excellent initiative you have taken. Sir, one of the point on the operation hurdles, because I have been in the NIT system for last almost 30 years. Now, we have different type of institutions, IITs, NITs, who are academically and administratively autonomous. There are some institutions who are actually doing very well, because I was in AACT as advisor, I know the institutions. Now, there are a set of institutions who are affiliated to universities, but they are not academically independent. So I would say that your the effort will be more useful and more effective if you can't call some of the vice chancellors here, and how exactly can we implement it through them, so that the institutes do not have any hurdles to operate on that. They can concentrate on the course content.
Right.
Because many of the, I have seen when I came over here from Mangalore, directly I came from Mangalore, there are more than 5-6 institutions, they approach me, sir, I want to see, join this program, because I had a talk in Suratkal, and they were very happy. But they are affiliated to the VTU. So they said, why don't you talk to the vice chancellor and let the initiative be taken by the university? So they'll be having more effective interactions. Okay.
Thank you very much for raising this. In fact, this is precisely the worry that all of us in IIT Bombay also had. So you will notice that the invitation which IIT Bombay sent was not to all 5000 engineering colleges. It was not even to all 400 institutions which are autonomous in amongst these, but it sent this invitation to those autonomous institutions with whom IIT Bombay has had a relationship through the remote center activity. And that is because we know each other much better than any other arbiter. Now, to answer Dr. Gopal Mukherjee's question, the point is very well taken. So, let me tell you my interaction with AICT and UGC. There was a UGC committee which actually recommended that universities should be encouraged to factor 15 to 20% of their degree credits to be obtained through MOOCs. UGC has been sitting on that report for more than 1.5 years. We submitted in January, I was a member of that committee, Professor Ram Thakole headed. AICT independently has indicated that there are no problems if institutions take the MOOCs courses and MOOCs credits. The formal notification whether it has come or not, we do not. Unfortunately, even the autonomous institutions do not exercise their autonomy on their own. As you rightly said, some institutions like IITs or NITs are completely autonomous, their own senates and all will decide these matters. But if I am a college which is academically autonomous but affiliated to a university, then I do not know to what extent I can exert my autonomy. That is your worry. So let me tell you, I had a chat at least with a few vice chancellors of technical universities to which lot of these colleges are affiliated. Maharashtra does not have a technical university, but Professor Maheshappa from Visveshwara Technological University said they are very keen to start this experiment. The vice chancellor of Gujarat Technical University is very keen to participate. In fact, in one of the interaction which Dr. Vittal Kamath, who is was participant of one of our remote center coordinators, mentioned that when this matter was discussed in a conclave of Gujarat Technical University college teachers and college principals, it was suggested why not permit, see, every college has to give 20 marks as internal marks and some 80 marks as final exam marks from somewhere. So Vittal Kamath suggested why not colleges can give these 20 marks based on the MOOC score, and the vice chancellor said that's a perfectly good idea, you don't need anybody's permission to do that. Internal mark is your own mark. You are not accountable to university how you conduct it as long as you do it properly. Now, that is the extent to which some of the vice chancellors are willing to go. But I agree with you that vice chancellors should endorse if the colleges which are autonomous even amongst us but are affiliated to a university, because eventually a university will have to endorse it. I am very happy to note that Rajiv Gandhi Pradyogiki Vishwavidyalaya from Bhopal is actually physically represented here. There is somebody from, yeah, and in fact he is none other than the registrar. So what do you say about this endeavor, sir? Is there a formal position of the university on this?
Actually, sir, we are recently we have conducted one workshop on CBCS, choice based credit system.
Right.
And in this system, we are going to offer the many elective and the departmental core and other subjects. Of course, looking into that and the faculty and the quality faculty and as well as the students' need, we definitely will be looking to that those students which are required, which are very much interested in taking the other subjects,
right,
they can go through these MOOC subjects and
yeah,
so on.
That's so this was of course a general question, but let me come to a specific question. You have in Madhya Pradesh several institutions affiliated to your university but which are autonomous.
Right.
Now, I suppose your university will have no problem if autonomous institutions decide to factor MOOCs in any which way that they want to?
No, sir.
Good.
Yeah.
Because this is an important thing, because if I were, for example, in Madhav Engineering College that Prajain is, or in Tokekar's institution or JSITS, I would be concerned little bit, although I am autonomous, but I do not know what stand will take. But you can see now how beautiful and positive endorsement is coming.
MITS is already doing, sir. MITS is already doing, sir.
Oh, you have decided already. So, in fact, let me also share with you, I do not want to steal the thunder from Dr. Nasa's presentation, but I have been requesting AICTE, NBA and other accrediting institutions that when they evaluate programs of the institutes or when they evaluate institutes, should they not give some additional recognition to that institute if that institute is going out of the way to adopt such technologies as online. We will wait for Dr. Nasa to make his presentation, then we will know his views on this matter. But I see a lot of positive vibes, people are willing to take this positively. So this issue about autonomous institutions but which are affiliated to universities will now be resolved, and you are very right in suggesting that. Frankly, let me admit you something, when we wrote this letter, we are not sure what would be the response. I was willing to run this experiment because I am seeing that it is writing on the wall that eventually the MOOCs will supervade everything, and I am convinced that we must mainstream it. But I was not sure of the response. I had written to 100 institutions and I was expecting 5, 7, 8 institutions to come. Now with those 5 or 7 institutions, I could have personally gone to each vice chancellor and talked to him. Frankly, I never expected 52 institutions in this country to come forward. This again has never happened anywhere else in the world, I think. And I am very thankful to you because that shows that a large body of the academic leaders in this country are willing to experiment and move forward. I will tell you, that is why I am saying that this group is destined to create history. When this news reaches MHRD, when this news reaches UGC, AICTE, that 52 institutions are working together to blend the MOOCs with this, I think there will be movement that will start. So, you are starting this move. So, this recognition problem, sir, I would actually be more worried about institutions like IITs and NITs and deemed universities on quickly getting these ratified in their academic body. That's not a problem.
Sir, I am from Walchan College of Engineering. Our institution has started with online examination using Moodle. So we will find this particular platform will be very easy for our faculty members. We already decided that 20% assessment which is going to be there, which can be done through this MOOC, and the 30% assessment which was there for mid-semester examination, for which we are going to request to you that we will send some of the questionnaire. Some questions will be from your side, and we can conduct even the online examination for the mid-semester also. So we can have the 50% of the component which is evaluated through the MOOCs.
Very good.
And 50% will be end-semester examination which will be conducted at our institute.
Very good.
Level.
So what he is suggesting, there is an important, there are two elements in this. One element is how you can increase the percentage of marks of MOOCs to be considered for the credit. Now that is welcome. But the mechanism what he is suggesting is that his institution would like to send some questions to be considered as part of this mid-sem. The problem, professor, is like this. I can understand what you say, but if I am in another institute, I would also feel like doing the same thing. Now, if I get questions from 52 institutions in a single mid-sem exam, it is impossible to conduct. The mechanism that we are suggesting is, please conduct your online portion of your mid-sem as a supervised exam internally. If you want, use the same platform, but run it at your place. As a MOOCs organization, it will be impossible for IIT Bombay to run a composite activity of any kind. So, for the first year, the experiment that we are doing is, we are saying MOOCs will run as is. Your teaching and learning will run as is. However, to blend it, we would establish T10KT workshops with where the teachers teaching those courses in your colleges and the teachers teaching MOOCs from here will constantly interact every fortnight through those workshops, through AVU, and will resolve any issues that come. The point is, you will tell your students to do MOOCs seriously because some marks are being contributed to that course. Now, whether you take 20%, whether you may decide, for example, that the mid-sem exam, if it is conducted for a MOOCs, then you will simply say that mid-sem exam for the MOOCs will be supervised in my college. So, although IIT Bombay may say the mid-sem exam is open for 3 days, we will conduct it from 4 o'clock on Friday evening to 6 o'clock on Friday evening. And there you can say that they have done it in a supervised fashion. when we give you the marks of the students, you will know whether that student was physically present there between 4 to 6 or not, and you can decide whether to take those marks or not. So, such are the additional working procedures that we can do that. But for the time being, we would not like to add on anything to the MOOCs directly. However, through these T10KT workshops, which will run for each of the three subjects, there will be significant contributions which will be solicited from the participating teachers. And all those additional contributions will be put as additional material for the MOOCs on the main course. You are most welcome to add. So, for example, the questions that you want to add, add them as practice problems and let all students benefit. No, why only your students? So, that is the approach, but thanks for pointing that. Yeah.
Formally put two slots in our structure for the MOOCs. We have open elective courses / MOOCs. Students are permitted to take any course either from NPTEL, MOOCs, EDX, Coursera, earn credit, and we accept those credits.
Oh, you accept those credits directly?
Yeah. We started.
Kya baat hai?
We started. We have two slots.
I think they are the bravest amongst all of us.
And taking inputs from this your talk, we will immediately start from next session to have a co-assessment activity at least for the some fundamental important courses. And on the behalf of College of Engineering, sir, we are thrilled with these efforts. We wish to salute these efforts.
Well, we all salute all of us because we are together creating a history. Thank you. Yeah, Dr. Kekar.
At Devi University, we already made the regulations almost complete for CBCS systems, and in CBCS systems, we are trying to introduce this MOOCs as well as foreign university grade transfer and so on. One question I would like to ask, that if there are similar courses offered at say in MCA department or electronics department or energy department, is it possible for them to take this course or not?
Okay, so two answers to that. First of all, our courses which are run on IIT Bombay X as MOOCs are actually open to all. We do expect a few lakh students, in fact, to register for these three courses when they start running. A segment of these 1 lakh, 2 lakh students will be the students which belong to our institutions who are doing this as a part of their regular course. So, the courses are open. If other people want to take it, they can take it. But whether they will be able to accept the marks of these MOOCs into their own credits or not, yes and no. But this is a good suggestion. What he is suggesting is, if I can expand on Dr. Tokekar's observation, is that currently our blended activities are limited to these 52 institutions. These 52 institutions are some kind of dadas who are saying, we are going ahead and doing this. But I am not a dada, I am a small institution, but I would also like to benefit from this. Now, I am a teacher who says that, let us say, my internal 20 marks, I will be willing to take from MOOCs. But please give me those marks. Now, I have these 100 students, you have these lakh of students, you are treating all lakh of students, 2 lakh students uniformly. These 52 institutions, you are treating them specially by giving them information about marks. Can you do something for me as well? So, my answer to this is, very good suggestion. I will now write to all 80,000 teachers who have ever participated in our teacher training program. They represent 4,000 colleges. I will write formally to AICTE also, and I will offer the following. Any college which wishes to consider some assessment from MOOCs as part of their assessment, whether internal marks, whatever, whatever, all that they need to do to us is register on a separate site. This is my college, this is the course, and this is the list of students. All that we will do is, at the end of the semester, for that list of students, whatever are the marks scored by them on the MOOCs, we will just dispatch a formal valid file to them. Will that be good enough?
1 minute. Actually, thing is, like Devi Hella University, IIT is one of the UTD.
Okay.
So, School of Computer Science, Tanwani's department, is another UTD. Dr. Ashkema's department, electronics department, that is another UTD. There is an energy department. They may be offering this thermal course.
I see.
And once we pass the regulation, students of those departments would like to join it. So, okay. That is the…
So, what you are saying is that recognizing only one institution…
Only one engineering institution
May not be good enough.
Good enough for university like system.
He is smart. He is trying to say that I am present on behalf of one, but I have four institutions. Please recognize all four of them. I will tell you our problem. We can run these T10KT associated workshops, which we believe are equally important because that will establish the interaction between our teachers and all other teachers, only for those teachers who are participating. Now, we might be able to extend that workshop attendance or participation facility to teachers from those colleges. And we might extend this facility of joining this. I do not know. I would not like to answer offhand, but we will look at it positively and we would like to solve this problem. So, to translate his question again is that while 52 institutions are here and we are all assuming that each of the institutions will have these courses to run, there seems to be a situation where there are sister institutions in that area itself who are willing to offer these courses and whether they can benefit from this one.
For across the board.
Yeah.
Okay,
so what you are saying is your regulation will facilitate whether they can participate in this experiment.
It will be
or not.
Same for all institutions. So, it will be there for them also.
I think we will pose this question to the advisory council to be formed as the first important question to be answered. We will go by their advice.
This is Partha from Vellore Institute of Technology. You have rightly mentioned that this MOOC, it is there in all, no universities in the world has taken it as the regular credit system. But the question is, many autonomous universities are there. So, is autonomy the only problem that because of that they have not taken? So, this is one thing. In fact, the certification of EDX and Coursera, we give some incentives of our professors who do this kind of certifications, and we got some feedback from them that the most of the cases, these courses, ADX, Coursera and other MOOC courses, not making them to think. So maybe this is another problem. So we need to think seriously that what the factors stopping them, the autonomous institutes, not to make it as integral or essential credit to take.
Very good point. What he's saying is that they are not convinced that the MOOCs courses enhance the thinking capability of the students in that subject. Let me tell you something. We have done a very deep analysis of these and we have seen multiple courses. A large number of courses offered on MOOCs platform, including well-known platforms such as Coursera and EDX, do suffer from this incongruity as you mentioned. The questions that are there in their evaluation do not require a lot of thinking on your part. So, such things may happen. In fact, this is another reason why we are not starting with large number of courses which are under preparation here. These three courses, first of all, let me tell you two things. These three courses which are offered on MOOCs are exactly as they are offered in IIT Bombay. There is no difference. These are not specially tailored for outsiders. They are courses that are offered in IIT Bombay. The questions that are asked in our quizzes and exams are exactly like the questions that are asked in quizzes and exams in IIT Bombay. Professor Bhandarkar has actually run a flipped classroom of thermodynamics of this course last semester before offering it here. And we are convinced that the way these questions are asked, it makes people think. There is a misnomer that multiple choice questions cannot be designed to test people's thinking. That is not correct. Okay. But we will not go into that debate. Let me assure you that the courses that are offered, we had this worry in our mind. Are these courses guaranteeing sufficient quality of enhancement of power of thinking and knowledge to the student? We believe it does. Okay. Now, whether it actually does in your opinion or not, will have to be found out. So, there are so many things which will be discovered when we do it now. There are no answers already available. We have to find them out. But I am sure we are not offering these courses without testing it. Why I emphasize this is when later members of the consortium would be willing to offer courses as MOOCs courses and may request either us to run or you will run and others will join. Please keep this observation in mind that the course is not just because I have some enthusiastic teachers who want to give a course, but the course is designed, experimented and tested to ensure that there is a huge impact on the better learning experience of the student. Unless that happens, we are not designing MOOCs for the sake of MOOCs. So that point is well taken, sir. But I can assure you that as far as these three courses are concerned, I mean, we have gone through precisely these questions. Do you know, for example, to set a quiz for my programming course, I know we have a team of TAs. They work over a week and assemble a set of questions. Then our team, including Professor Supratik and I, would spend at least 15 to 20 hours in deciding how the final quiz should be framed, how the explanations for the right answers and wrong answers should be given. That is the amount of effort that is required. There is no shortcut to that. But thanks for bringing out this.
Hello, good morning,
sir. We could have
a
couple of more points.
Dr. Manoj Kumar Deshpande from NMIMS Shirpur campus. And my question is just fundamental issue of offering MOOC, because all of we are worried, and even we have heard from IIT faculty also, the attendance of student in the classroom is really point of worry, because 100% attendance we never get, and even it is reduced up to 20-30%. By offering such kind of, then the reason may be because IIT gets very high quality or good quality students, and so they are able to study there by their own and referring and accessing some resources. Of course, it is not my view, but I am just putting and representing this view of others. So this MOOC will not enable student to remain away from the classroom actually, and then the second part is whether this kind of online offering, online course offering will reduce the requirement of faculty and professors at a large throughout the nation, and reduce employment particularly in education.
Oh my God.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, we are not here to solve the employment problem of the country. Second of all, let me inform you from my knowledge of the problems that our institutions face, including IIT Bombay. We do not have adequate number of qualified and experienced teachers in any one of our institutions. All of us desire to have more people. I think all of us sitting here will endorse it. We are perpetually struggling to find faculty. If I meet somebody at an airport who is good enough, I'll tell him, why don't you join tomorrow? That is the situation. So let's not worry. About attendance, let me tell you something. Attendance is not a new problem, by the way. When I was a master's student in 1969, we also had people who bunk classes. Avinash Auday never attended any class to the best of my knowledge when he was a student. It didn't matter to him. The point is not that. The point is you are considering MOOCs as a separate activity and classroom as a separate activity. That is the jinx which we want to break. Please understand that we are sitting here not to say we will run this and we will run this. We are blending it. So let me tell you how we blended it. I had 100% attendance in each of my classes in CS 101, although there was no lecture, do you understand? But there was 100% attendance. Two stratagems. One, each lecture hour was converted into a discussion session, problem solving session. In fact, one problem we faced was that the furniture is not arranged in a classroom which is conducive for group discussion amongst 10 or 15 people. That is another. Second, at the end of every class there was a quiz. A handwritten quiz, a simple paper was circulated. Please remember, even if there is half a mark associated with an activity, student will not miss that. Now, that quiz was based on the discussion that happened in the class. People could not prepare it earlier. It required us 4 to 6 hours to decide on how to conduct the discussion and quiz for every lecture. We spent that time. I would expect your teachers to spend that time. Do not treat MOOCs as something as an addendum. But see, if this week this particular topic is being discussed, I normally teach it in a particular way, but I see that my teaching and say Gaitonde's or Bandarkar's teaching is similar, then I will say the following, which is what we do here. In this week, I will announce to my students, there will be no lectures, but you will be required to listen to Professor Bandarkar's lecture before coming to the class. In the classroom, we shall have discussion. We will solve problems. Which problems? Well, I may not be able to compose problems. That is where through the T10KT workshop, I will ask Professor Bhandarkar in advance when I interact with him. Okay, boss, I want to propose to do this. Please tell me some problem that I could discuss in this class on this topic. And Bhandarkar will help you, saying this is the tutorial that we had done last time, these are additional problems, and these are the suggested problems for quiz which you may conduct. Now, when that teacher announces that in this week, the classes will only have discussions, problem solving sessions, but a quiz every class. Do you think anybody will miss? But that requires time and effort to be spent by your teacher. If they do that, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, so this point is so important that I thought I would emphasize it in a different manner also. So the point here is that in the 20th century, if you think about it, information was at a premium. And the teacher's main role was to bring that information accessible to the student. Whereas in the 21st century, now the information is already available. That's all that is being provided by the MOOC. So if you are a teacher who is continuing to simply provide the information to the students, yes, you will become redundant. But as a 21st century teacher, if you say, okay, these are the new skills that my students need to learn, the skills being critical thinking, coming up synthesis of information, coming up with new ideas, collaboration, communication, these are the 21st century skills which our students need. So if you are a teacher who is saying that these are the skills that my students need, and that's what I'm going to be providing to them, then the discussion part of the MOOCs which are going to happen in the blended phase in your classroom, they are going to be invaluable for your students. And by experience, we can tell you that students will come to the class. Teachers who do this do not become redundant.
Thank you. I will tell you, in fact, the discussion sessions were so passionately participated by students. And in every class, there are some very good students, some not so very good students. But you see, when a general discussion happens, every student benefits. This is not
and most
new.
Of the students are now using that CodeChef and other problem
today,
solving techniques on those websites.
Today they have CodeChef and other things. In 1963, when I was a student in JSITS, there were some teachers who taught from their 1948 class notes. So this is not new. But even then, there were teachers who were extraordinary, who will read the most recent things and teach. And even today, there are some teachers.
Yes, so what we wish to happen
is to begin with in these three courses and subsequently in all other courses, our teachers imbibe and incorporate this kind of interaction that Professor Sridhar Iyer is saying.
Because what students are telling is same thing Dr. Sridhar said,
yes.
That actually if you are giving just information, everything is available on website, on books, yeah. We can read it.
But Dr. Tokekar, I will tell you also the problem. Now I put myself into the shoes of a teacher in your department and I am being advised to do all this. Whole discussion session, solve difficult problem. I will tell you my problem. I am a teacher in your place. Arey Baba, I have myself not solved such difficult problems in my life. Now, I do not feel confident of facing my students with these difficult problems. That is where I am saying, you will tell me that, look, Fatak, I understand you have no experience. But now, this Bhandarkar and Gaitonde are going to talk to you every fortnight. And are going to tell you how these discussion sessions could be held. That is the advantage of adjacent T10KT workshop, which will run simultaneously, not for 2 weeks, it will run for 6 months, spanning the entire course. So this point is well taken. I think we are getting late for this. Yeah.
Sir,
we'll take
one question, please.
Yeah.
I'm Dr. Preeti Singh, head of electronics department in MIT University, Haryana. Sir, as you floated three courses, thermodynamics, C and signal and system. Being a teacher of signal system, how can I contribute in the existing system? As you already floated signal system, if I want to put some good assignment in this, how can I contribute?
Yeah. So as I said, the contributions for this limited experiment will come in the following fashion.
Okay.
All the teachers who teach these courses in participating institutions,
yeah.
They will form a sort of sub consortium of that subject. And the T10KT workshop which will be conducted involving all these teachers will have assignments.
Okay.
Now, what assignment do I give a teacher? I don't ask him normal quiz question.
Yeah.
The assignment will be, can you contribute an interesting example?
Okay.
Can you contribute a problem for discussion?
Yeah.
Can you contribute a video lecture?
So
now, you make all such contributions.
Okay.
The IIT Bombay MOOCs team, which has an authority to decide what goes on to the MOOCs course,
okay,
I will request them to consider putting all of this as additional material with due credential.
Okay.
We have only one request. We do not put any material on our MOOCs which is not in open source. So anybody who makes a contribution with an intention to put it on the MOOCs must give a clear undertaking that A, there is no IPR other than what I have created, and B, my IPR I am voluntarily giving to the Creative Commons for inclusion in this. These are the two conditions that we have, nothing.
To write short notes on DC motor. So they go to internet DC motor, whatever they saw there, they write that in that textbook, in that notebook, sir, I have written this in short note. They don't prefer to see the textbook.
Professor, let me tell you, I think you should read my paper, which was, I gave as an invited talk in 2014 January, where I had said precisely the same thing. When I was studying in Indore, I did the same thing. There was no internet then. But I knew that somebody will ask, write short notes on these three. Somebody will ask, explain something. Somebody describe this thing. I could mug and answer those questions. More importantly, when I reached third year, I could even predict what questions will be asked because several questions were repeated. I will tell you, I am responsible if I ask this stupid question, write short notes on. What is the meaning of writing short notes in a technical paper? When I came to IIT Bombay, I was shocked to find, first, no option. I was used to saying, solve any 6 out of 10 questions. Second, no explain, no short note, no nothing. Problem 1, problem 2, problem 3, problem 4, problem 5, paper end. Now, why do you think IIT system has not fallen from the sky? But why this system produces people who perhaps are better problem solvers is because the questions that are asked are like this. I will tell you, we must scrap the current system of examination completely. If we don't do that, we will not inculcate thinking. You are talking about internet. In Madhya Pradesh, several students told me, when I asked them, what do you read? Something called Shivani, they said. I don't know what Shivani is, some guidebooks or whatever, whatever. Yeah. And in every state there are guidebooks. Why they are reading it? Because they believe that they can crack examinations reading those guidebooks. But you tell me, in a classroom where I hold this session, and in this session whatever discussion happens on those problems, my quiz is going to be based on that problem. Where will guidebook or internet help? I have to change my ways as teacher. I have to change my ways as assessor and evaluator. Unless I do that, I have no right to expect that my students will come and participate. But believe me, if I change my ways, they will participate. This non-attendance problem is there everywhere, including in IIT. But I will tell you, wherever we are running these blended MOOCs, Professor Kannan has run it for 5 years. Professor Sridhar Iyer also ran CS101 throughout the semester. We had practically 100% attendance. I mean, some attendance would be less, but we always say best 5 quizzes out of 7 will be taken or some such thing. So it is possible to do that. Thank you.